Sing that song to yourself. Sing that song to yourself, everybody. Let's rise up. I'm going through. I'll pay the price. Whatever others do, I'll take the win with a love despise and fuel. In this new month, and even for the rest of the year, and for the rest of our lives. We are grateful for hitherto you have brought us. We are grateful because you will not abandon us. We are grateful because you are able, your power is available, your presence is with us. Father, as we come again, in this new month, a new day, a new month, new opportunities, new possibilities in our lives, in our spiritual lives, in our families. King of glory, we believe and we trust that you will see us through.
Amen.
You will lead us through.
Amen.
You will help us to succeed.
Amen.
We will excel in this Christian race.
Amen.
We will not be left behind.
Amen.
We will not backslide.
Amen.
We will not turn back.
Amen.
We will keep on moving forward. Irrespective of whatever challenges we may have, we will keep stepping forward in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And on a daily basis, we will be going higher.
Amen.
We will be going stronger. We will be doing greater things for you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And your glory will be from glory to glory.
Amen.
Our strength will be from strength to strength. So shall it be. Thank you for the answer. Blessed be thy holy name. For in Jesus' mighty name, we are praying.
Amen.
I thank God for you who are able to make it to church this morning. I bless the Lord for the opportunity to worship with you. It's been a great day as far as I've seen it. And I believe it's been a great day with you also. And I believe God will make it greater. God will make it better. And God will keep you stronger in Jesus' name. And for those of us at home, we bless God for you too. You will be getting stronger.
Amen.
The righteous also shall hold on to his ways, the Bible says. Those of us who believe in God and trust God, we shall be getting stronger.
Amen.
We'll be getting better.
Amen.
So shall it be for us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank God for what we have learned today, and we are here to cap up our study. That's why, just for us to have enough time to go through this, we have taking out the review, and so we'll spend a little more time on the message this morning, because some very, very heavy stuff that are in the passage that we have today. So open your Bibles with me to Philippians chapter 3. I'm just going to pick two verses there, and that will become the anchor for our message this morning, the pursuit of God. Can everybody say that?
The pursuit of God.
Can everybody say that? We need to pursue God. You know, I've had a preacher, I once had a preacher who said, you don't need to worry to pursue God because God is always pursuing you. I think that's half gospel. That's half gospel. That's not, you know, however eloquent they may have said it, it doesn't make any difference. It's half gospel. God is expecting you to pursue him. Yes, he's pursuing you.
He said, with an everlasting love, I have loved you. That's the pursuit of God. He's pursuing us with his love, with his mercy, with his favor, with all of the resources that heaven, you know, can give to any human being. God is pursuing us with that. With the life that he has given unto us, God is pursuing us with that. With the favors we receive every day, God is pursuing us with that. But God expects us to also pursue it. It's when you preach eternal security, you are going to tell people there's no need to pursue God. There is need to pursue. You cannot get the best from God if you don't pursue him. Apostle Paul says, I'm pressing towards the mark. What does that mean? I'm pursuing God. I'm running after God. I want the best that God has. You know, when God came to Abraham, he says, walk with me and be thou perfect. That was God pursuing him. But Abraham reciprocated too. He started walking perfectly. That's why the Bible said it was counted unto him for righteousness. God pursuing us. We also pursuing God. So this morning, we are looking at, what's our title now? Say it confidently. The pursuit of God. I picked three verses there from chapter 3, verse 13. It says, brethren, here is Paul, apostle, in his most potent proclamation. He says, brethren. He says, let me put myself here, because if you have read Philippians chapter 3, there was so much about Paul, apostle, there. So much about him. And so much about him that you can put yourself there. Your accomplishments. All the laurels that you have won, the gold, the medals, the honor that you have received, whatever it is. But Paul said, I can't all of them, but dung. All I'm doing is pursuing God. I'm pursuing God. That's all. That's my priority. I pray that will be your priority. Amen. Pursuing God for the rest of your life. Pursue him till you meet him in eternity. Amen. Never look back. Don't be like Lot's wife. Jesus said, you remember Lot's wife. She was told to keep pursuing safety. Safety in the Lord. Safety in God. But she won't pursue it. She remembered there was something behind. Then she looked back. And we're told she became what? A pillar of salt. A lot of people are looking back today. And God is speaking to you through Apostle Paul in Philippians chapter 3. He says, brethren, when I think about myself, I don't count myself to have apprehended. I am not there. God apprehended me. Meaning God caught up with me. God pursued me. Acts chapter 9, you can read, you know the story. God pursued me. It is a difficult thing for you to creak against the brick. That's God pursuing Paul. But now look at Paul. A good example of a human, you know, human model. We don't have humans as models for us. But if you're going to look at any, Apostle Paul will be one of them. It will be very high on the scale of a model that you can put forward to everyone. But Paul said, God has apprehended me. I am pursuing God now. I don't even think I am there by any shot. Verse 13 again. He says, brethren. He counted you as a brethren. He looked at you and said, you are my brother. You are my sister. That's what I count you to be. Inasmuch as you are a child of God. Of course, the epistle to the Philippians is to believers. It's not to unbelievers. Of course, believers can pick things there. They can see things there. But he says, here, I'm talking to those who are already children of God. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended. But this one thing I do. One thing. You know, it's like Jesus Christ, look at that man in the Gospels. And he says, one thing thou lackest. Paul said, I know that one thing. And I'm pursuing it. I'm pursuing it. One thing that I need. This one thing I do. Forgetting those things which are behind. You know, there are a lot of people, they look behind a lot. This problem, that problem, from their home, from their city, from their garage, from their up, from down, from people, from friends, from in-laws, from parents, they are so combat with life. And they're not even enjoying what God has given us. You know, every time I want to get to a point where I want to think too much, God always reminds me, and I love that. God will tell me, the one I've given you, have you finished enjoying it? God always reminds me of that. Anytime I'm giving to thinking I don't have this, God always reminds me, the ones I gave you, have you finished it? Praise God. And I think it should be the same with you. What God has given, have you finished it? The blessings you have now, have you even enjoyed it? A lot of people won't enjoy what God gave. And they are so concerned about this happened in the past, this happened in the home, this happened there, and they are so cumbered and worried about it. God says, enjoy the moment. Tell somebody, enjoy the moment. Enjoy your Christian life. God brought you peace. God brought you gladness. You know, he didn't just give you gladness, in fact, he actually gave you joy. Because there's a distinction between the two. When you are glad, it's about something around. It's more about things you can see. But when you have joy, it's an internal thing. Joy is like a river, like the Santoros now. You know, it springs. It's like a spring. It comes out. There is nothing prompting. It's internal. It's Jesus on the inside. That's joy. That's what joy is about. So when you have joy, let that joy bubble out. Let people see you are a joyful person. Let people know that you are a believer. This is what this epistle is about. What you have received, enjoy. Paul said, listen, whatever happened in the past, I'm not bothered about it. What is happening now is that I am saved, I'm a child of God, and I'm pursuing God. I'm pursuing him. I'm pursuing his holy. You see, pursuing God means pursuit of perfectness, perfection, pursuit of holiness, pursuit of his honor, pursuit of his power, of his glory. That's what I'm pursuing. I'm pursuing divinity. I'm pursuing eternity. Paul said, that's all that matter to me. He says in that verse 13 again, I go back, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind. They beat me in Ephesus. I fought with beasts in Ephesus. You know, they threw me through a basket. They did this, they did that. Look at all that I went through. They even left me for dead. I forgot about that. I didn't even know even that that happened. All I'm thinking now is, how can I get to the best of God? How can I reach the best of God? It says, forgetting those things which are behind, I'm reaching forth. I am pursuing unto those things which are before. Praise God. The things which are before. What is before you? Glory. What is before you? Honor. What is before you? Eternity. What is before you? Jesus. Looking unto Jesus, the one before you. Don't look at the distractors. Don't look at distractions. Don't look at whatever the enemy is doing. Look unto Jesus. He's the one before you. Don't be distracted. Tell somebody, don't be distracted. I'm going to be talking a lot about distraction today. Praise God. It's what this message is about. It's because when you run through the epistles, you are going to discover that. What Paul wrote to them is basically about there's too much distraction. You have been distracted and you go from one congregation, Philippians, Ephesians, Colossians, you're going to see unique kinds of distraction. And if you come to a congregation here in St. Paul, I'm telling you, a lot of distraction. What did I say? A lot of distraction. Personal distractions. Things that shouldn't distract you. When your goal should be to pursue heaven, you have been distracted. Every ant that go around you, you look. Every rat that move around, you give meaning to it. God says, stop being distracted. Then he said, even the air of your head cannot fall to the ground without me knowing. So why are you so distracted? The Lord will help us. Paul said, no more distraction. He said, no more distraction. He says in verse 14, I press, that's the pursuit, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Brethren, this passage is heavily loaded. We can spend the whole of today on a message like this, but I'm going to make it very, very short, as short as possible, because I want you to get the best of it, and I want us to pray about it. Amen. It's a good day. It's the first Sunday in August, and it's a good Sunday to pray. Amen. By the grace of God, I'm going to bring all of this to my Thursday time with you. You know, let the other members in the other churches know. Thursday is going to be special for us. This coming Thursday, I'm going to bring all of this in, and we're going to be able to pray more about it. Amen. About distractions and problems and situations, and we are too focused on them, and it's hindering the goal and the purpose of God for us. The goal of God will not be hindered in your life. In Jesus' name.
So this passage is so loaded, we cannot comprehend. In fact, we need a lot of, we need the power and the strength of God to comprehend the breadth, the length, and the depth, and the height of it, as Ephesians 3, verse 18 rightly says. So, in our first review, in our first opportunity to read this passage, I told us that Paul was refocusing the believers, especially the Philippian believers, on the foundational principles. Because when the foundation is destroyed, you can't do much. So foundational principles of salvation, you know, of trusting God, of faith, you know, of living the life in the spirit, he was refocusing them on those principles by which if no one take care, they will derail. He says this has to do with the essence of our discipleship. The essence of discipleship. Paul was focusing on that. What our concerns must be based on as followers of Jesus Christ. And then he goes on to say, listen, as it comes to the following chapters now, he began to tell them, he says, number one, there are distractions. Number two, there are detractors. Distraction, detractors. They are distracting you, they are detractors, they are distracting you. So you must make sure that you don't put your eye, you don't focus your eye on it. Pursue God and look away from every distraction. You must have the eye of the Spirit for you not to miss your way in this jumbled existential living that we are in. And so things are jumbled up. But you must have single-minded focus. Amen. That's what Paul is saying. Because the goal is that you will distinct yourself. Amen? Through discipleship, not minding the distraction and the detractors, you will reach distinction. Amen. I said you will reach distinction. Amen. So as commendable and contagious and committed as the Philippian believers were, Paul discovered that their light was shining as it ought to be. Due to what I call an avalanche. You know what an avalanche is? You know, when you go to the mountains and the snow and something disturbs the snow and then it begins to rush down and all those things that are packed up there, I'm telling you, that avalanche, possibilities are, if it doesn't bury you totally, that we don't see you, you may even die. And for the Philippians, there was an avalanche that was ready to bury them and is beginning to encroach and implode upon them. So Paul said, avalanche of spiritual misfits abode in Philippi, in Macedonia, as I gave you the history last week. There was an avalanche of spiritual misfits. People were eccentric, oddballs. Those are misfits. Eccentric people, oddballs, people's way of thinking is just totally out of the ordinary. Avalanche of them. And when you have too many of those around you, they distract you. They're going to tell you things that make no sense, and in an attempt to understand them, you forget the real thing you are trying to do. And you get lost in their own eccentricity. So there was an avalanche of spiritual misfits. There were prophetic prognosticators. Big word, but it just simply means forecasters. Forecasters. And people cannot focus on God anymore. They are looking for somebody to forecast for them what's going to happen. They were just all over the place. You remember Simon the sorcerer? Amen. You remember that woman that was following the lady that was following Paul? Yeah, it was all over there. It was in Philippi, it was in Macedonia. Here are the people of God that do this, that do that. You know, prognosticators. People love them. Oh, they said, but he said something. Listen, aren't Paul and his co-travelers, are they not people of God? Uh-huh. So do you need any prophetic gift to tell people any of that? No, there are some things naturally that we can even know by our mind. But people will use it to bring us to captivity. And because our minds are not focused on God, those things distract us. So, in Philippi, and in the cities around in Macedonia, spiritual misfits,
prophetic prognosticators,
predictors, diviners, psychics, sorcerers, soothsayers, they were there.
Faith formulas. Those who don't have faith, but they're just fumbling with a form of it, having a form of godliness, the Bible says, but denying the power thereof. Faith from people just fumble up. They don't know the true things, but they just show up and they have good English, good words, and they wrap everything up in some suit, you know, in a word that when you receive it, you say, that's rhema. There's no rhema there. Think very well, you will understand. They are not saying anything. Your mind is not focusing, and so you can't even. So they totally got you off your game. But they will use words to upset you. And then you say, I've not had that before. Then you are glued to them.
The Lord will deliver us.
These are people, they cook a little scripture in a lot of untruth. They are bound there. And they force feed those that they have bewitched. Like Simon the sorcerer. Scripture says he has bewitched them. And so whatever he says, that's what goes. Spiritual misfits, prophetic prognosticators, faith fumblers, religious rabble-rousers. Who is a rabble-rouser? A rabble-rouser is an agitator, an activist. Spiritual activists. Their actions doesn't support scripture, but they will quote scripture by every means. And they will do everything possible to tell you, why are you not supporting this? Because, you know, I remember somebody once walked to me in the church here, and he said, Pastor, I said, yes, we are going to need the church because something really bad is going on in the church, and this is about the church. I said, what do you mean by that? Then he told me the story. So I told him, I said, that has nothing to do with the church. That's a personal problem you are having. You cannot drag us into it. He said, no. I'm a Christian. And this thing that I'm doing, the church must back me up. Now, this is not our regular African brother, so don't think too highly about it. It's actually a Caucasian that, you know, I got to know in some of the pastoral meetings. And he says, no. Deeper life must be part of it. I said, no. We are not going to be part of that. Now, this same person we later on learned that even though he was telling us that this has nothing to do with the business, he was collecting 30-something thousand from the county every month. And he wants to, we who doesn't get a penny, we don't even need the money. We don't need his money. That's his business he can do. But now, look at how people can rope you into things that has nothing to do with. But from the beginning, I just told the guy, I said, no, we can't be part of this. And he was so mad. And now his true nature came out. He called me every printable name you can think about. That's how, I'm not kidding. I won't stand here and tell you, and it's within this building, it's not somewhere else. Yes, later on he came back and said, Pastor, I think I lost my mind. You know, I'm really so. I said, yes, truly you lost your mind. You have to have lost your mind to see some of the things you said to me. I said, but you know what? Forgive me. But I have to make it an example to let you know that there are things going on around us. Distractions. What's our job as a church? We are not activists. Praise God. The job of the church is to show people the way, to teach them the truth, to let them know how salvation. And the Bible is our compendium. We can't pick other people's books. This is it. The Bible is. Anything that is here is good. I said it's good. So we pick our command, our conviction, everything, commitment. Is all in here, and we stay there. Praise God. So we're not going to join any religious rabble-rousers, agitators, demagogues, activists, provocateurs, troublemakers, using religion as instrument of domination. They were all there at Philippi. That's why they arrested Paul and put him in jail. I'm sure you have read Acts 16, 17, right? That's where Paul ended up in jail with Silas, and then they began to Paul and Silas, they pray, right? And the Holy Ghost came down. Philippi, Macedonia. Praise God. That's where it happened. But who are those who are, what was he doing? He was basically talking to people about God, and they arrested him and put him in jail. Activists, they will go against you. They are louder They are much louder. You know, they will hear their voices. They are few in number. They are not always many. They are few. But they are louder. And everybody will hear. They have the megaphone. Religious rabble-rousers, they have megaphone. They will make noise. And Paul said, that's not the pursuit of God. Pursuit of God is holiness. It's righteousness. It's about eternity. It's about going to heaven. It's about having your sins forgiven. It's about becoming a son and a child of God. It's about your focus on heaven. It's about the word of Jesus Christ. You know, don't pay evil with evil, but pay evil with what? With good. That's what the Bible says. But religious rabble-rousers will say, if anybody tried, I'll get them arrested. I'll do this, I'll do that. I'll use my clout out there to arrest you. That's why they arrested Paul. We're going to deal with him because he cannot come here and take over our territory. They think everything belongs to them. Rabble-rousers. God will deliver us. Brethren, I'm emphasizing all of this because they are also around everywhere. Everywhere. Anywhere you go. Not just in this church. All over. Not just in the West, but even in Africa. Probably even more in Africa than here. Paragration. I've not been in Africa for quite a while. So, you know, the only thing I know about Africa now is what I see on the screen and all of that. Even though I grew up there. I know more about here than over there. But what I'm saying in essence is that don't localize it to the West. It's everywhere. And every believer, every child of God must make sure that you are focusing on what God wants you to do. I pray you will not lose focus. I will not lose focus. In the name of Jesus. And so they present themselves as the real deal. They present themselves as what? The real deal. You know, Acts 16, if you look at it with me, verse 17, verse 16, say, and it came to pass, as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination met us, which brought our masters much gain by soothsaying. A lot of people use religion just for money, and they'll be into anything for the money. Everything. Now, is money bad? No. But the Bible says, the love of money is what? The root of evil. You know, when people love money, and then they are rabble-rousers, the two of them mixed together, it can be, you know, it's a bad potion. You know, it destroys a lot of things. So he says, brought her masters much again by soothsaying. He said the same follow Paul and us and Christ, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, which show unto us the way of salvation. You know, in an elite society where God sent Paul, he came across so many of these. And you can read your scripture, you are going to see it. In Acts 13, there was another one, the first prophet, a Jew, by Jesus, you know the story. They're all over the place. They are distractors. They will distract you. I pray you will not be distracted. But listen, what God has given unto us, we must focus on it. We must not act as though comfort and luxury are our chief requirements in life. Yeah, the Bible says, having food and raiment, let us do what? Be thereby or therewith content. But the love of money is the root of all evil. It distracts people. It distracts people. You will not be distracted. Amen. I said you will not be distracted. Scripture says in Romans 14, 17, it says, the kingdom of God is not in meat and drink, but what? Righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. That's the focus. That's what we should be pursuing. May God give us the commitment to pursue that in the name of Jesus. So, as we look at our message this morning, very quickly, three areas as I talk about what obtains in the Philippian church. Now, I'm going to make allusion to other congregations. The Corinthians, Ephesians, Galatians, Colossians, Thessalonians. And we're going to see what happened there, the kind of distraction that you have. So, first point of our message is the fog and filthiness of distractors or detractors, if you call them. Either distractors or detractors. That's the same word. The fog. The problem with distraction and detractors is that they create a fog. What is a fog? A fog is anything that will not allow you to see clearly.
Lately, we have a camera on the this side of the church, and typically we can see the parking lot, we can see, you know, so many other things, and then on this side too we can see. But lately I just discovered at night there's a huge fog on that thing. Before it was not there. I could see clearly to everywhere, to the farthest place on this side and this side. But now in the last 1 or 2 weeks, I don't know what happened. During the day you can see, but at night, it's like there's a big flare on it, and you cannot see anything outside there. And that's dangerous. Very, very dangerous. And that's the way detractors act. They act as a fog. They become a clog. They become a covering so that you cannot see properly. So we are talking about the fog and filthiness of distractors or detractors. The illustration is about a man who almost drove into a ravine because of a huge fog in front of him. And he escaped just because he was very watchful. He suddenly saw something very unusual. And he was in a corner where, you know, it's not usual for you to pay attention. You just think it's a corner. But for some reason, he paid attention and he almost got in. So he stopped right away and he remained there. And he stood by his car and he began to wave to everybody. He began to wave to everybody to make sure that nobody else fall into the ravine. You know, sometimes when we preach a message like this, somebody will say, "What is your problem?" Well, our problem is that we don't want people to fall into the ravine. The ravine of life, of hell, of hellfire, of destruction, caused by the messages of distractors. Which, for the Philippian church, and I'm going to go through some of these distractions in a way that you will understand. Scripture says in 1 Timothy 4:16, the reason why we do this, the fog and the filthiness of distractors. 1 Timothy, open your Bible, please. Chapter 4, verse 16. 1 Timothy 4, verse 16 says, "Take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this, thou shalt do what? Both save thyself and them that hear thee." Listen, the message ministers preach, I don't know if you understand it, but first of all, it is to themselves. There's no way you can preach a message that doesn't affect you. There's something must be wrong. It has to affect you. It has to cause you to examine yourself. What you are saying in your mouth, do you mean it? Otherwise, you become like the Pharisees. Matthew chapter 23. You know, scribes and Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. All that they bid you, you know, do. Say, all they say to you, do it. But don't do as they do, because they say, but they don't do. Praise God. So unless the minister is a Pharisee, then he will not be able to understand. But here we are told, take heed, because the message you are preaching will have to save you first. And through you, it will get to others. See, that's why most of the times we as believers, we don't understand where the gospel the world is reading. People want to, if you say you are a believer, people want to see what you have believed. They want to see your commitment, your faith in your life, in your family. If that gospel is not working in your life, in your family, it will not save anybody. So it says, take heed. Take it. Watch out. Be watchful to the doctrine. And to yourself first. Because if you lose yourself, you cannot understand doctrine. You have to get yourself right. Your foundation must be right for you to be able to understand doctrine. Amen. He says, continue in that doctrine. Continue in that word of God. Because when you continue, you will save yourself and you will have an addition. I said you will have an addition. You will not be alone. You will not go lonely. You will not go empty-handed. You will save yourself, and then by the grace of God, you will save others. Those who hear you. And I pray as many as are hearing the message of God through us, they will be saved in Jesus' name. Our message will not be in vain. So, Paul said, there is the fog and the filthiness of distractors and detractors. And I want to take you through a couple of them. Number one. The fog of division, of camps, of immorality. It abounds in the Corinthian church.
That's why Paul wrote the epistle to them, 1 Corinthians. And when you look at the kind of prayers Paul prayed for them, that's when you know the trouble there. His prayers always, reflect the trouble, the problem that they are having. He said, and this I pray. Well, he was praying by knowledge, by understanding for them. So look at the Corinthians. 1 Corinthians, we go to chapter 1, verse 10. 1 Corinthians. So when you come to the Corinthian church, the problem of division, of camps, of immorality was all over the place. 1 Corinthians 1, verse 10. Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that ye speak what? The same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, that ye be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. He's still talking to them about the pursuit of God. He said, if you are going to pursue God, there has to be unity. Go back to Genesis chapter 19 again, that I told you before, where Jesus said, remember who? Lot's wife. God gave them a message. Flee to the mansion. Don't look back. They were all going. Lot, the wife, and the daughters. But as they were going, the one that was not united with them, he was not thinking of the journey they were making. She was thinking of, what did I leave behind? What can I get? What is it? You know, she was filled with the world. She left Sodom, but she was in Sodom. And so, for a moment, she forgot herself and said, even though I could be saved, but I'm not going to be saved because I have something to look back to. And then she looked back, and the Bible says she became what? A pillar of salt. That's lack of unity. When the husband in the house says, by the grace of God, this is our focus, this is where we are going, let's all be focused on it. Amen. You know, sometimes I think the Lord will help us, even as a church. Praise the Lord. The Lord will help us as a church. That even where we are trying to give accommodation to other things, we will not do it to the exclusion of Scripture. When you come to the Ephesians, you are going to see what Paul was saying there concerning the family, right? That if we are pursuing righteousness and holiness, maybe let me quickly go to the Ephesians. Ephesians is going to be the fifth chapter. In verse 21, it says, submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God, why submit yourself to your own husbands as unto the Lord? For the husband is the head of the wife. This is where I want you to think about now. Even as Christ is the head of the church. You know, sometimes we may preach in a way that makes the woman think that at home, I'm just the same as my husband. No, that's not what the Bible says. And I know that's going to be, activists will go against you on this. But we are reading Scripture. It says, do what? Submit to your husband as if you are submitting to who? To the Lord. To the Lord. So we have to be careful not to minimize Scripture. Because when it is not done properly in the home, there is problem. And we're wondering, why is there a problem in the home? Because the husband and wife are striving. And everybody wants to be the head. No, there's only one head in that home. Scripturally speaking, it's the husband. It does not matter his stature. It does not matter his height. You may be a wife that is taller than your husband. That's great. That's just physical. You know, that short man is still the head of the home. You know, quote and unquote, or whatever it is. That man who is not very rich and you are richer, is still the head of the home. So you have to understand that. That's why things don't work. So when people don't obey Scripture and they see that things don't work, they are wondering. You have to obey Scripture. If you say you are a child of God, obey the Bible. The Lord will help us. I said the Lord will help us. So we will not minimize Scripture. You give it exactly. That Bible says he's the head. It's like somebody saying Jesus is not the head of the church, because the Bible compared the headship of the home to the headship of what? The church. He said, as Christ is the head of the church. So if things are going to work in the home, the head has to be correct. He has to be recognized. You have to put the head where it belongs. If you put the head down and the feet is walking over the head, then you are not going to get anywhere. Figuratively speaking.
Praise the Lord.
So here are the issues at stake that he was trying to address. He said, Corinthians, there is division. You are not united. You don't have one goal. In fact, where you say you are Christians, you are believing God, some says Apollos. Some says Peter. Some says Paul. You know, I'm of Simon. I'm of Apollos. And then Paul said, is Christ divided? You can't be, you know, is the home divided? How can the home divide? The Bible says, when you are divided, he said, if a city is divided, it will be conquered. If a home is divided, it will be conquered. There has to be unity. I pray there will be unity in your home. I pray there will be unity in our homes. And I pray there will be continued unity in our church in Jesus' name. It doesn't matter what you think, how you feel. The Bible is the thing. Follow it. It may be difficult, but follow it. It may be tough, but follow it. And God will give you grace. So for the Corinthians, he says, division. And then he goes on to talk about, it's not just division, there is disorder. There's even disorder in the church. People are not orderly. In chapter 5, he says, it's reported commonly. Bad things reported commonly in the Corinthian church. This is the essence. When you are pursuing God, bad things must not be, you know, because those things are, you know, it's like the story of a dog, a hunting dog. He started running after an elephant, right? And he says, I'm going to get this elephant, right? I'm going to get this elephant. And then a gazelle, or a deer, as you call it, ran across. And he says, ah, that's a deer. Okay. He left the elephant and he's pursuing the deer. And you know the deer runs really fast and kept running and said, ah, you know, what is going on? Am I going to get this deer? And then a squirrel came across again. Ah, he says, squirrel, that's, you know, let's leave the deer. And then as he's pursuing the squirrel going trees and all of that, and it's like, is this possible? Then the little mouse shows up and say, okay, maybe I'll just catch this. Did you see where he came from? From an elephant to a mouse. And unfortunately, he caught none. You see, when people are divided and they don't have focus, things they can get easily through cooperation. Think about it. Hunting dogs don't go alone. They have others. So what if the hunting dog can just partner with the other? Maybe you have ever watched, you know, Animal Channel kind of thing. You see the dogs. They are the vilest. When they are pursuing, they don't give up. They just keep running, and they tire you out. Because they are sure that other animal will get tired. And sure and simple, they get tired. And they will catch them. Listen, if you don't give up on your goals and you keep pursuing and you keep persisting, you will catch your goal. Amen. You will reach your goal. Amen. You will get to your destination. The distraction is that you get tired or somebody made a comment or somebody said something and then you say, I don't need that anymore. What do I need? Look at the comment. Look at what. If you have a goal, it doesn't matter what people say. Just achieve your goal. That's what matters. God is not going to mark you on the basis of what the distractors and distractions are. He's going to mark you on your achievement, what you got. And I pray you will get something. Amen. Corinthians, well, let's move quickly because of time to the Galatians. They are the next congregation here. Galatians, you know them. Oh, foolish Galatians. Do you know the problem with them? You know, because of time, let me run to chapter 3. Chapter 3 of the Galatians. Because that gives you, really, he says, verse 1, O foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? Did you see that? Bewitchment. What does it mean to be bewitched? You have a goal, and then somebody should talk you out of it. And he tells you, that place you are going is not good. That thing you are doing is not good. Project you are handling is not good. Or why are you doing it? To what purpose? Don't you see? And then they give you excuses, and then they sweet talk you out. And then they show you a wrong way. He says, receive ye the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith. Are ye so foolish, having begun in the Spirit? Are ye now made perfect by the flesh? Distraction. Did you see it?
For the Galatians,
terrible distraction.
Look at chapter 2, verse 4 and verse 18. Let me read that quickly before I move out of there. You're going to see this all over the place. Verse 4. And that because of false brethren unaware brought in, who came in privily to spy out what? Our liberty. That's the essence. That's the, to spy. They see that, you know, praise the Lord. Brethren, as a church, we've been distracted. Please pardon me to say that. What happened to us between the running church and the not available church? That's a parable. I hope you get it. What did they used to call us before? The running church. You are going to church and you see that it's 5 minutes to service to service. Ah! And people don't drive in those days. You know they walk. In Africa, they walk. They are not driving to church. Most people, they are walking. And they are in suits like me, going to church with their bag. They look at the time, you know, service is going to start in 5 minutes or whatever, they start running. So people don't even know the name of the church, they say they run in church. What are we running to? We are pursuing what? God. But now, do people run? Distraction. Distraction of soothsayers. Distraction of the mountain people, the valley people. Distraction of fire. Some of us, even the ordinary things we do now, is no longer sufficient. Bible is not sufficient. Prayer time is... People will not be available even for their prayer, but they will be looking for where people are praying. How do you understand that? You set up your own prayers, they will not show up, but they are saying, I need where people are praying. So what are we doing? We are sleeping. Distraction. Soothsayers, they are taking you out of your position. They are taking you out of where you are. May God forgive us. Amen. Church, may God forgive us. You know, sometimes you have to confess your sin. I'm confessing our sin to God in this message. Too many people are distracted. And you are pursuing other. You don't even know what is going on in those places. Have you ever asked God about those places you are running to? Have you ever asked God? Because if you ask God, God will tell you something. Not that they are evil. I'm not talking evil of anybody. They all have their calling. And I pray that they will succeed. If it is by God, they will succeed in Jesus' name. Amen. But if it is not by God, God knows how to deal with it. It's not my job. So I'm not bothered about them. But I'm bothered about me and you. That we should not be distracted. The fog and the filthiness of distraction and detractors. God will take it away. Amen. I said God will take it away. Amen. So he said, Galatians. People have come to spy your liberties, which is in Christ Jesus, that they might bring us into bondage. You know, many of us, we don't usually say, I have bondage. But now, we have had that prayer so much. We too are now saying, but I'm not saying it. I'm not in bondage. I am free in Christ. I said I am free in Christ. No bondage for me. No bondage for my family. No bondage for this church. I said no bondage for us. We are moving forward. We are pressing towards the mark. God will help us in Jesus' name. Paul said, we thought that I had, I'm not even there. So, whatever we have now, we are not there yet. Either we have enough or we don't have enough. Wherever we are, if Paul is not there, we are not there. Because there's so much we can get in Christ that we have not gotten. And God will get us there. And it starts with uniting in your home, uniting with the church, and we're moving together. If you don't unite at home, we can't unite in the church. Husband and wife cannot be disagreeing at home and then they come and pretend here that there's unity. No. The strongest link is the weakest link. Our strongest point is what? The weakest link. And it can be just a family. So God with God will destroy every distraction in Jesus' name. Amen. So here he says, look at what is going on. We have liberty, but now we are losing that liberty. So we must gain that liberty back. We have the liberty of the scripture. We used to say, praise God for the word of God we hear. And we believe that word. Listen, do you know why the miracles were happening before? We believe it. We believe that word.
We believe it so much that when the word is preached to you, you just take it. But when you begin to dissect the word, and you don't even believe it, yes, of course, you can be a Berean Christian, praise the Lord. And I want to encourage you to be that. Don't limit yourself to whatever you've been taught. Amen? Aha! The Bible says be a Berean Christian. You know, examine the word, dig into the word, look at the root of it, look at where it's coming from, understand the depth of it, look at how they connect together, how things connect themselves. For example, you are reading about the Philippians now. If you don't read Acts chapter 16, you will not understand how the Philippians came to be. It will just be an epistle to the Philippians. Who are they? Philippians are part of Macedonia. Where did we see the issue of Macedonia? Come over to Macedonia and help us. Acts chapter 16. You have to connect that. That's what I'm talking about. Connect the dots. Get a deeper understanding of the word of God. But don't be moved. That's what happened to the Galatians. They are being moved from their foundation. And when the foundation is destroyed, everything is destroyed. I pray God will keep our foundation. Amen. God will keep your foundation. In your home, the foundation of unity, oneness, God will keep it. In our church, foundation of unity, holiness, God will keep it. So, Galatians, let's go to the next church. What's the next church? The Ephesians. Well, you know the problem with Ephesians? Works. You know, that's where the temple of Diana was. Eh? Great is Diana of the Ephesians. And they almost killed Paul there. They almost killed him because, you know, of false worship, idol, taking over everywhere. And for us in the United States, I'm telling you, the idols are creeping in a lot. Have you driven through Dale Street? You get to Dale and Front. There's one huge thing on the ground there, if you have not seen it. I don't know why they have not moved it up, but that's how, you see, when you read the Bible and they say, Solomon's time, he made temples for this, he made temples, that's how it starts. He had a god of his wife, and you know, yeah, when the people of the land begin to marry strange people, and the strange people take over your land, then they bring their idols. They bring their little, whatever name they call it, they bring it little by little. Before, it was small, small. You go to a place you want to go and eat, they hang it everywhere. But now they say it's not sufficient to just hang it in places where you eat. We have shown you enough. Now we want to erect it in your cities. Very soon, somebody will say, White House. There has to be an effigy of, then they'll mention the God in the White House. And then it goes on and on. It's little by little. You know, there's something they say in Africa, which many of us say. They say, you know, let me just sit here. That's how the stranger will take over your father's house. It's just, no, I'm just, look, don't give me a room. All I need is just a little place to, I'm just going to sit here. In fact, if I want to sleep, I'll just lay down there. I'm not going anywhere, just little. Then, in about a month, you know, you wake up in the morning and you see that person lying there. You say, how can he just sit down there, right? What do you do? Okay, I'll give you a room. Then he takes a room. Before you know it, he does what? He takes the whole house. That's how America is being taken over. But God will take it back. Amen. I said, God will take this nation back. Amen. You see, when you open the door to all kinds of gods from everywhere, and then you know, the smart one among them, they will rope their pride, the God, the practices of those gods, they will rope it into your health system, your health care system. They will rope into your social service. They will rope it into everything. And little by little, they say, well, it's just, I didn't say they should do it, it's just an alternative. If per adventure, they are not able to sleep. You know, you can just help them to do yoga a little bit. You know, it's not, just, you know, just something to relax them. What religion is that? Buddhism. That's what you are doing. Yoga. You have become a Buddhist. Part of the principles of Buddhism. Praise God. It starts little by little. It's not always in big things. It's not always in big things. It's little by little. The devil will just be taking the ground, taking the ground. So you have to be careful. And the devil starts taking the ground in their home when there's disunity. That's where it starts from. Because you see, if there is no crack, look at proverb now, pardon me. The lizard cannot coming. Many people around here may not understand that because there are very few houses are cracked around here, right? But in Africa, I mean, all our mud houses, they are all cracked. And the lizards go in. And so we use a local proverb. If there is no crack in the wall,
The lizard, the gecko, cannot go in.
So there are cracks in people's spiritual life, cracks in families, cracks everywhere. And Paul said, this is what we come to. If we are pursuing God, we must fix these cracks.
And God will fix them for us.
Amen. But listen, we have to take that first step. That's the thing with God. That's why this thing of pursuing God and God pursuing us, it's both ways. You know, he says, sanctify yourself.
I am the Lord, I just what? That sanctify you.
Why can't he just say, go and sanctify yourself and you'll be fine? No, he said, I do it, but you have something to do. So if you are pursuing me and I'm pursuing you, we have to do it together. God will help us. Praise the name of the Lord. So that's the Galatians. Maybe I should just, because there's so much there that I can tell you about the Galatians. But let's go to the Ephesians. The Ephesians. Did we just talk about the Ephesians now? Yes, we talk about the Ephesians. So, Galatians. It says they were what? They were bewitched. We talked about them. Amen. What of the Colossians? What happened to them? Colossians. Look at Colossians chapter 1 verse 23. Colossians 1, 23. Colossians 1, 23. If ye continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel. Can you read meaning to that? Paul is indirectly saying that they are what? They are already moved. They are shifted. So he is just trying to, you know, Paul has a good language of how he speaks to people. He may not condemn you outright. Sometimes he does. God gives him the liberty to do it. He will do it. But while he's trying to encourage them to promote their faith, he will tell them in a subtle way what is going on. He says, you already moved. You shifted. Your foundation is not straight. So the only way is to be grounded, to be settled. And then he talks about the reason for that, which you have heard and was preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, am made a minister, who now rejoice in my suffering for you and fill up that which is behind of the afflictions of Christ in my flesh for the body's sake, which is the church, whereof I am made a minister according to the dispensation of God, which is given me for you to fulfill the word of God, even the mystery which have been hid from ages and from generation, but now is made manifest to his saints, to whom God will make known what is the riches of glory of this mystery among the Gentiles. Here is the word now, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. He says, you need to rekindle that connection with Christ. That's the only thing that will ascertain glory. Rekindle it. Solidify the foundation. And then glory will be possible. I pray glory will be possible for you in Jesus' name. So as you look at all these churches, and you come to the Thessalonians. Thessalonians, they are one of the few churches that Paul praised. One of the few. First Thessalonians. Look at it. First Thessalonians. The brethren in Thessalonica, they were one of the few churches that Paul praised. In fact, all he did was to encourage them to continue in steadfastness. 1 Thessalonians. Let me go to chapter 2, verse 13. And you being dead in your sins, and circumcision of your flesh that has he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, blotting the handwriting. Oh, pardon me, I'm still reading Colossians. Colossians, I should be in Thessalonians. Chapter 2. It says, for this cause, in verse 13, also thank we God without ceasing, because when ye received the word of God, which ye had of us, ye received it not as the word of men, but as it is, how? The word of God, which effectually worketh also in you that believe. Thessalonians. Because you come to the first chapter, he praised them. He says, from you sounded out, verse 8, the word of God, not only in Macedonia and Achaia. You know, the Thessalonian church was younger than the Macedonian church, but they became teachers. They became example. Praise God. Did you see that? They became a better example. Paul said, Philippian church, look at the Macedonians. Philippian church, look at the Thessalonians. Look at what is going on there. And then Paul said, I am hearing that they even become the example. The word of God is going through the Thessalonians.
you know, to Thessalonians and Achaia in verse 8 that we just read. He says, so being affectionately desirous, that's in chapter 2 now, of you, we were willing to have imparted on you not the gospel of God only, but also our own souls, because you were dear unto us. Thessalonians, beautiful church, commendable church. I pray we'll be a commendable church. I said we'll be a commendable church. And even though Paul was going everywhere, but it was in Thessalonica that he said he wanted to go there, he said, but Satan hindered me. Yet, nothing could hinder the faith of the Thessalonians. Their faith stood. Yes, with all that the devil is doing, he couldn't hinder them. You will not be hindered. So telling me whatever the devil is doing all around us shouldn't hinder us. We should stand solidly on the word of God, and the Lord will keep us. I said the Lord will keep us. I said the Lord will keep us. In the name of Jesus. So, Paul Apostle, talking about these fiery distractors, he said that you and I must make sure that we don't allow them to distract us. And Jude, the brother of Jesus, said something about them in Jude 1 verse 8. He said, likewise also, these fiery dreamers, they defile the flesh, they despise dominion, they speak evil of dignities. In verse 4, he says, they crept in unawares, who were before of old ordained to condemnation. Ungodly men, turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness and denying the only God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 10, he says, but these speak evil of those things. This is the effect of all of these things. They speak evil. This is the fog that they create in people's eyes. They speak evil of the things they know not. But what they know naturally as brute beasts in those things, they corrupt themselves. They corrupt themselves. He said, woe unto them. They have gone in the way of Cain. Remember Cain? The one who was angry because of his brother? You know, he says, a lot of people are like that. You know, if things are getting better for their brother, they get angry. If some people are living a good Christian life and be obedient, they get angry. And they look for a way to bring them down, to, you know, to discourage them. The way of Cain. And ran greedily after the error of Balaam for reward. You know what that means? And perish in the gainsaying of Korah, Korah, Dathan, and Abiram, in the book of Numbers. He said, these are spots in your feast of charity, when they feast with you, feeding themselves without fear. Clouds they are without water, carried about of wind, trees whose fruits wither, without fruit, twice dead, plucked by the roots. He says, in verse 13, raging. Raging waves of the sea, foaming out their own shapes, wandering stars to whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. Here is the fog they create. They are not going anywhere. They will not allow you to go somewhere. But you have to determine that no matter, you know, what distractors are doing, you will get somewhere. I will get somewhere. I am going somewhere. Heaven is my destination. In my pursuit of God, there will be no fog in my eyes. In the name of Jesus. And this brings us to the second point, you know, that just basically says, you know, the fracture or the fault line in distractions. When there is distraction, when there is fault line, what does it create? It creates room for problems. And that's what we just read in the book of Jude. It says, they are fiery dreamers. You see, speaking evil becomes easy. Corrupting themselves becomes easy. Going the way of Cain becomes easy. Greediness becomes easy. The error of Balaam becomes, you know, it's normal. Nobody cares about that. And then he goes on to say in verse 16 of that Jude 1, he says, these are murmurers, complainers. That's the fourth line that is created. You know, instead of unity, there's so much people just, you know, husband murmur against this, children murmur against this, everybody, you know, and things don't add together. And Paul says, when you are pursuing God, these things become a fog. You can't see clearly. You can't see far away. He said, these are murmurers, complainers, walking after their own lust, and their mouths speaketh great swelling words, having men's person in admiration because of advantage. Advantage. You know, it creates a fault line where everybody is looking for their own advantage. What can I get? What is in it for me? If I can't get anything, then why should I be there? That's what happens when there is the fracture or fault line of distraction. That is, there's a crack, there's a rift, there's a split caused by distraction. So, brethren, as you think about fault lines and distraction, think about an egg that dropped. Can you put it together totally? You may attempt it. I'm not saying you can't attempt it. You will attempt. In fact, the shell, you may use a glue. But it's not going to be the same. See, that's what happened in many families. When these fault lines, fractures happen, every attempt to put things together, the devil just will not allow it. So that's why it's better not to even allow it to happen. I pray God will keep us. I said God will keep us. In the name of Jesus. We must know what we are pursuing. We are pursuing Christ. We are pursuing heaven. Distraction must not blind our eyes. You know, there was a sign on the door of a business. It says, gone out of business because we didn't know what our business was. I don't know if you've ever seen that sign, but it says, gone out of business because we didn't know what our business was. When the believer doesn't know what his business is, he's going to go out of business. When you don't know that heaven is the only business you have, when you don't know that Christ is the only one you are looking at, when you don't understand that whatever people all the joy, you know, it's like an athlete running. And somebody says, you are already too slow. And then he gets mad. He wants to stop to talk to that one. He has lost. It's that simple. And believers are like that. We are athletes. There's a race set before us. And there are too many distractions. This one talk, that one talk, this one say, that one say. And people want to, you know, it's like I tell them, everybody want to prophesy to your life. You know, sometimes in the morning you wake up and your phone is making pim, pim, pim. You know, all kinds of rubbish is coming in. There's nothing good there. It's one person hiding in the corner of somewhere and say, I've been on the mountain and I declare to your life, which mountain are you? Do I even know which mountain you are in? And then I'm going to wake up in the morning, I'm going to listen to that. God forbid. I said, God forbid. Ah, say that to yourself. There are some things you don't wake up in the morning and listen to. Read your Bible. Pray. Do your devotion. That's what you do in the morning. Don't allow, you know, all those noises that come in. Early in the morning, they'll be bombarding you. And your phone is making all the noise. If possible, shut the phone off so that you can concentrate. Praise God. You have to know your business. You know, distraction causes a whole lot of accidents. Amen. And I'm not just talking about driving only. Yeah, distracted drivers, I'm telling you, they have ruined homes. Distracted believers have ruined lives. They ruined their own, they ruined their families. People get distracted and to compensate for it, they may end up in adultery. People get distracted, they compensate for it, they may go to drink and then they end up in an accident. People get distracted, you know, they get mad and whatever, and all kinds. Homes have been ruined because people's faith is no longer the same. Where you can keep your faith, you can keep your head, happy are you. Amen. Glorious are you. Amen. I pray God will give you that grace. Amen. To keep your head and your home in Jesus' name. Amen. Distracted driving, they compromise safety. The safety of the driver, or passengers, or pedestrians, or people everywhere is the same thing. Distracted believers. Believers who are under the influence of distraction. All kinds of things happen to them. And if care is not taken, think about it. If it's a distracted pastor, it can get a whole congregation into perdition. Distracted pastor. Can you show me one in scripture? Aaron. He was the high priest under Moses. And for a little time, Moses went to talk to God. Before he came back, the distracted man has been overcome. They are easily overcome. When somebody doesn't have a goal or a purpose in life, they are easily overcome. Everything that people say around you will interest you. It's not everybody you put your ears down to listen. It's not every message you must listen to. It's not every preacher you must listen to. If God puts you under a ministry, there's a reason. Praise God. There's a reason. God knows that there's something in your composition that will be met. I've seen people jump around, and they jump into a lot of trouble. That will not be us. Amen. I said that will not be us. Amen. It says, for this sort are they which creep into houses. 2 Timothy 3:6. They leave captive, silly women laden with sin. led away with diverse lusts. Verse 7, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. People learn a lot, but they are not able to make use of it. Make use of the scripture. That's what Apostle Paul is talking about. He said, there's so much we are teaching you. Make use of it. Grow in it. Let the student become better than the teacher. There's nothing wrong with that. Praise the Lord. Yeah, it's good. It's okay. Don't say it's only our teachers we should. No. If you have more knowledge than your teacher, that's better, because that means you are going to succeed him. Amen. So let the teacher go and rest sometimes, and let those who have learned come up. Amen. That's why we are praying our children will be better than us. Amen. Praise the Lord. That's my prayer every day. None of my children will be less than anything I have been. Amen. The least any of them will be is better than me. Amen. In every area, spiritually, physically, secularly, the least they will be is a better version of what God has done in my life. Praise the Lord. And I pray you'll be so in your family. In Jesus' name. We will not be ever learning, never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Because when you learn and learn and learn and learn, and you don't use it, it becomes a problem. You become distracted. No distracted believer is saved under the influence of spiritual distractions. You are not saved when you are easily distracted spiritually, physically. You must take distraction away. That's what Paul is saying. You are pursuing God, don't be distracted. If heaven is your goal, don't be distracted. People will abuse you, it doesn't matter what they say. They don't determine heaven for you. Don't allow anybody to take you out of the race. Follow God, follow His will, do His will. If there's restitution to be done, go ahead and do it. It's not about any man, it's about God, it's about heaven. That's the pursuit of God. Put this right at all times. Don't allow the enemy to blame you in any area. If he blames you wrongly, that's okay. We do that. But don't let it be that you are suffering as a murderer, or you are suffering as a busybody in other men's affairs. And then you say, oh, it's all about me now, because no, if you are a busybody, then other people will be busy about your own business. So let's follow God. Let's follow the scripture. Let's follow the word of God. The fog of that distraction and detractors, what happened at the end of the day is that it's what the scripture says in Hebrews chapter 5. Hebrews chapter 5, it says, verse 2, it says, for the time ye ought to be teachers, ye have need. Ye have need. You ought to be what? Teachers, but now you are a needy person. You are very needy. You should be teaching people now, but they have to find a teacher to teach you now. You are so needy. You've learned so much, but it has not impacted anything. It's like a student who have been in school. You know, who has been in school for 10 years in a college, and he couldn't come out with any degree. And they are rolling him from one department to the other because he just couldn't have a grasp on anything. Too many believers are like that. They've been in Christendom for 10, 15 years. And they can't say, this is what I got. This is what I brought out. This is what I've achieved. This is where I stand. This is my conviction in Christ. Our conviction is in Christ must remain. Actually, we must be building on that foundation. We must not lose our foundation. You will not lose your foundation. I said you will not lose your foundation. Rather, Paul was even telling us, he says, you should be building on the foundation. He said, even me, I'm building on what? The foundation of Christ. Amen. He said, I'm building on the foundation that Christ has given. I pray that you will build on the foundation of Christ. Amen. I said, you will build on the foundation of Christ. And the foundation of Christ will keep you secure in Jesus' name. Amen. I said the foundation of Christ will keep you secure in Jesus' name. Amen. So we must be very, very careful. Hebrews 5 again. It says, for when ye ought to be teachers, ye have need, you become needy, that one should teach you again
which are the first order of the oracles of God. When you are taught, you must have knowledge to be able to teach others. 2 Timothy 2:2. He said, when you are taught, you become a teacher. But now he says, you become needy, right? I'm becoming a teacher. A teacher of good things. When people come in with wrong things, you are able to teach them. You are able to show them the way of the Lord. You have need that someone should teach you again, which be the first principle of the oracles of God. And I become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. This is why people are in denominations for 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, and they are not better than those who just came yesterday. That will not be your portion. You cannot be in a place and you are in a place of work and they still give you the same job for the past 10 years. You have not moved up. Something is wrong. You see, if you get to those places of work and you see those people we meet in the place of work, maybe you came in with a degree and they don't have any and they just sit down there, they are not any. You see how angry they are? Sincerely, they are your worst enemies in any place of work. In Christendom, it's the same thing. When people don't grow, all kinds of things, all kinds of imagination come in because they are like the Dead Sea. They are taking in, but they are not doing what? They are not releasing anything. They are not releasing anything. What God gives you, you grow by releasing. Do you even know natural things? Trees. Praise God. We and trees, we are in a symbiotic relationship. Well, so to say. I don't know if that makes sense to us. Symbiotic means mutual. Helping situation. Do you know why they want to plant trees everywhere? What do we breathe out? What does trees need? Carbon dioxide. What does trees give? Oxygen. What do we breathe in? Oxygen. That's symbiosis. We are helping one another. Trees give you oxygen. You give trees carbon dioxide. When you see a city area where there are not much trees, you see the fog, even literal fog on the city up there, is because there's nothing catching all of those things. So both of us it's a relationship of giving and taking. It's the same thing even with God. Apostle Paul says, rejoice my heart, make me happy. God also wants to be happy when he sees you, that you are growing, that what you have been taught, you are moving on, you are becoming better. The Lord will help us. I said the Lord will help us. Paul says maturity is the important thing here. And God will help us to mature. Let's go to the last point. We're going to quickly wrap that up together within the next few minutes. Let's go to Philippians. The last point is faith's focus and our distinction. I told you in the beginning, our discipleship is leading us to what? Distinction. But between discipleship and distinction, there is this detractor and this distraction. We have dealt with all of that. Discipleship means you come to Christ, you become a child of God, then you are being taught, you are being led. But while you are doing that, you are just, you don't want to be like Gehazi. You are under prophet. What's your prophet? Elisha. And you are serving Elisha. And then here comes Naaman, the Syrian leper, the captain. And then you are so distracted by everything that Naaman brought. He brought this, he brought that. And then your master who can see clearly. You know, there was a time host came against Elisha. And the servant said, my master, what are we going to do? He said, we don't have to do anything. Praise God. You know, sometimes when people are panicked, it's because they can't hear God. Elisha said, you don't have to do anything. Because those who are surrounding us are what? They are more than those who are against us. So don't panic. There's no need to panic. A lot of times when people panic, I just laugh. I say, why panic? This thing is in God's hand. Say, my life is in God's hand. Uh-huh. Confidently, my life is in God's hand. So because I said, well, we have to take this. Elisha said, is it time for you to take sorrow? It's not time. Because Ecclesiastes chapter 3, there is time for everything. It's not time. Do we lack food? No. Do we have a place we are sitting, Gehazi? Do we have a place we are sleeping? We have not been sleeping outside. We are somewhere. Somebody is making provision and we are sleeping where they provided for. So we are okay. Having food and raiment, let us be there with content. Gehazi said no. But you know, unfortunately, what Gehazi got, he couldn't use. May we not labor for the wind. May you not labor for the wind. The things you are pursuing that is hindering your pursuit of God. At the end of the day, ask yourself, how many of them will you use? How many of them? That's why I told us in the beginning, when I'm getting anxious about it, God says, enjoy the one I gave you. Praise God. The one I've not given to you, who gave you the one you are enjoying? It's me, right? Wait. When it is time, I'll give you the other one. So, it's, you know, be careful for not my popular passage, Philippians 4 verse what? 6. Be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving. What happened? Let your request be made known. Yeah, you are going to lack something, and God may allow you to lack it for a reason. A lot of things we lack, we don't understand why we are lacking it. God says it's for a reason. I'm protecting you, I'm keeping you, I'm preserving you. You won't understand it. If anybody tell you it's not going to make sense, but just take it like that. Be careful for nothing. But in everything, by prayer and supplication, let your requests be made known unto God. So, our focus, this is what Apostle Paul was saying in chapter 3 of Philippians. Let's read it before we go to the Lord in prayer. Faith, focus, and our distinction. What will get us to the distinction? Look at that chapter 3. I read from verse 12. Not as though I have already attained, either we are already perfect. Paul said, I'm pursuing God, I'm not there yet, but I'll keep pursuing him. I don't even have all that I need, but I'll keep pursuing him. But none of them is going to distract me to the point that I lose this race and give myself cheaply to anything. Not as though I've already attained. There will always be something you need to get. If Paul says, I've not attained, I ask myself, what does that man want? He has gone to the third heavens. If I get half of that, I'll be glad. Praise God. You know, Paul has raised the dead. Eh? You remember where he was preaching and somebody fell, Eubulus, right? Boom! He said, don't worry, his life is in him. The man didn't even shake. He said, the man's life is in him. And it was exactly like that. But the man is saying, I've not attained. I'm not. What do we want? The man who almost seems to have everything. He has knowledge. I mean, look at all that he wrote. Look at the wisdom. Look at the understanding. But the man says, I'm still pressing on. There's so much to get in God. Brethren, that's your focus. There's so much to get in God. Don't limit yourself. Don't limit God. Yes, there's a situation now that you're having problem with, and you're asking yourself, when is it going to be resolved? In God's time. Everybody say, in God's time. Because in his time, he does what? He makes all things beautiful. Your life will be beautiful. Your family will be beautiful. Paul said, listen, I have not attained. Either were I already perfect, but I follow, I'm pursuing. I follow after, if that I may apprehend. Maybe I'll be able to get it in hand, that for which I am apprehended of God. Listen, read that passage. I am pursuing the goal for which God pursued me. Did you get it from that passage? There's a reason why God apprehended me. That goes back to where? Acts chapter 9. And he was giving an answer. He said, there's a reason that God apprehended. Listen, brothers and sisters, there's a reason you are in the kingdom. You are in the kingdom for such a time like this. And God has a purpose for your life. God has a goal for. Don't allow the fog of distraction and detractors to close your eyes and don't see it. You are in the kingdom for such a time like this. You are the Esther of today. I said you are the Esther of today. You are the Paul Apostle of today. He says, the reason for which I am, I know why God got me. I know what I would have been doing if he didn't get me. But because he got me, he has a reason. God has a reason for your life. Amen. I said God has a reason for your life. If there's something happening in your life now, there is a reason. You need to ask God, what's the reason? What's going on? And you need to believe that it's going to end in praise. I don't care what it is. Make up your mind. It will end in praise. Can I hear you say that?
Rise up with me. Let's end the preaching on this note. It will end in praise.
There is a reason. Is there not a cause? There is a cause. For my life, it will end in praise. I will not disappoint God. In this pursuit of heaven, in this pursuit of holiness, in this pursuit of Christ, there is a reason. And that reason will be fulfilled. That cause will be accomplished. In the name of Jesus, open your mouth and talk to the Lord. He says, Paul is telling you now, he says, I have not attained yet. I'm not perfect yet, but I am following after. Hallelujah. I am following after. I'm not giving up. I'm not looking back. I am following after. I'm not going to turn back. I am following after. Peradventure, by the grace of God, if I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended. Christ apprehended me. I was like a thief, a robber, but he arrested me. He apprehended me. He brought me into his prison. For 3 days, I couldn't see. God apprehended me. God arrested me. Brethren, I can tell you, I have a story. The story of my conversion is like that of Paul Apostle. For 3 days, I agonized. On the third day, the Lord spoke and he said, go to deeper life. Go to deeper life. Go to deeper life. And particular location is in mention. He said, that's where you are going. I have never been there before, but how I got there is only by the Holy Spirit. Nobody led me. Nobody took me there, but I got there on that same day. That's what I'm saying. The reason for your apprehension, can you ask God? The reason he arrested you, the reason he brought you to the kingdom, let it not be in vain. Let it not be in vain. It is for the pursuit of heaven. It is that you will be perfect. It is that you will be holy. It is that you will have eternity. It is that you will reconcile with God. It is that your life will be good and become a testimony for God. Open your mouth and say, Father, for the reason of my apprehension, let it be fulfilled. Let it be fulfilled. Fulfill your purpose. Fulfill your purpose. In the name of Jesus, fulfill it. Fulfill it. Your purpose in my life. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Brethren, in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Somebody said, it's in a very funny way. Pardon me. It's in a very funny way. It says, when you are up to your neck in alligators, it is difficult for you to keep your mind on the primary objective that brought you to the side of the pool. The primary objective you came to the side of the pool is, I want to drain this pool. Eh? But because you are distracted, you fall into the pool. That's why it says you are up to your neck in what? In alligators. A pool of alligators, you fall into it. Are you going to think of how you are going to drain the water? No. The first thing you are thinking is what? How can I save myself? He said, when you are up to your neck in alligators, you are surrounded by alligators, you are not thinking about draining the pool. You are only thinking about what? Saving yourself. Now, what are alligators? Distractions. What are alligators? Problems and challenges. What are alligators? The things that easily beset us, that makes us not to stand, that makes us not to do the will of God. You are up to your neck in alligators. I'm asking that God will release you from the alligators. Open your mouth and say, Father, release me. Everything that is like an alligator, everything that wraps itself around my neck, every distraction, every detractor. Father, release me, release me, release me, and help me so that I'm able to do your will. I want to do your will. I want to do your will. Open your mouth, open your mouth. I want to do your will. Help me to do your will, Father, in the name of Jesus, because I want to press forward. I want to press forward. I want to press forward. I want to move forward. I want your will to be done. I want your will. Help me, Lord. Help me, Lord. Help me, Lord. Help me, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Open your mouth. Open your mouth. Pray and tell the Lord. Pray and tell the Lord. The Lord will help you. Say, Father, there's a reason for my apprehension. There's a reason why you got me. There's a reason why you brought me to the kingdom. I'm asking and praying that you will give me grace to accomplish that purpose.
In the name of Jesus. There's a reason for me coming to the ministry. There's a reason for me being a believer. There's a reason for me even being here in this location. You have a reason. Everything you do has a purpose. Let your purpose be fulfilled. Let your purpose. Father, help me never to give up in pursuing you. Help me to pursue you until I accomplish your purpose for my life. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. As I told us, because of time, on Thursday, we're going to have a beautiful time of prayer. So I'm not going to take too much of your time. Give me a few minutes and then we'll round up. Maybe in about 2-3 minutes we'll round up. Amen. The prophet Habakkuk said in chapter 3, verse 17, although the fig tree shall not blossom, neither shall the fruit be in the vines, the labor of the olive shall fail. These are distractors and distractions. And the field shall not yield the meat. The flock shall be cut off from the fold. Distractions. There shall be no herd in the store. The man is basically saying, if I become impoverished, if I become poor, he said, that will not distract me. He says, yet. Everybody say, yet.
Yes.
Everybody say, yet. You know, the epistle to the Philippians is an epistle of joy. I'm not focusing on that area because when there's so much distraction, you can't have joy. Distraction and detractors, you can't have joy. So he says, Habakkuk said, even with all the distractions and detractors, yet I will rejoice. Yet I will rejoice. Say that to yourself. Yet I will rejoice. Yet I will rejoice. I will rejoice in the Lord. I will rejoice in the Savior. I will rejoice in the God of my salvation. I will rejoice. It doesn't matter what the enemy is throwing at me. I overcome. I overcome. I overcome. I overcome. Open your mouth. I overcome in the name of Jesus. We will overcome. We will overcome. In Jesus' name we pray. Finally, last passage now. Romans chapter 8. Paul himself. Paul himself said, what I'm preaching to you, I'm now preaching it to myself. You see, it's one thing for you to tell people do good, and you yourself, you are not good, you are not good. Paul says, no. He said, whatever I tell you, I'm doing it. He says in Romans 8:38. Romans 8. Please, let me open to it. This time, because I want to read all of it. I don't want to paraphrase. Romans 8. What's our verse? 38. Romans 8, 38. It says, for. In fact, let me go back to the distractions. Paul says, who shall separate me from the love of God? Tribulation? Distress? Persecution? Famine? Nakedness? Peril, sword, as it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. He said, but nay, in all these things, I am more than a conqueror. Through him that loved me, for I am persuaded. Can I hear you say that? For I am persuaded. I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate me from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. That's a commitment to be focused. That's a commitment to continue this pursuit. And pursue God until he calls you to excel. Make that your commitment as we finally pray. Make it your commitment. Say, Father, nothing will separate me from this race. Nothing will separate me. The enemy will not be able to keep me away in this race in the name of Jesus. I will remain committed. I will remain strong. I will remain rooted in righteousness, in holiness. Every distraction, Father, in the name of Jesus, I minimize them by the power of the Holy Ghost. They are minimized. They are destroyed. They are scattered in the name of Jesus. I will focus. Not even coronavirus, not even whatever is pandemic outside there, none of them will hinder me. I remain rooted, I remain committed, I remain consecrated to the cause of Christ. And I pray it shall be so for you in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Raise up your hand to heaven in commitment to the Lord. Make up your commitment now to them and say, Father, I come before you now. I'm asking that by your grace, all the consecration and commitment I've made today, resources to accomplish them, you will grant unto me. The strength to accomplish them, you will give unto me. I will not quit. I will not look back. I will not give up. I will not be discouraged. The enemy will not overcome me. I am more than a conqueror through him that loved me. I thank you for the victory you have accomplished. And I'm going to continue in that victory even to the end. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name I have prayed. Amen. Father, King of Glory, I thank you for your church. I thank you for the word you have given unto us today. I pray that as we have received this word, Father, let it burn on the tables of our heart. Father, I pray that we will run with this vision and will not allow enemy to keep us from pursuing you in Jesus' name. We pursue you until we find you, until we see you, until we get the best that you have for us in Jesus' name. There's a reason you have apprehended us. We were sinners, we were wicked, we were people should be in jail, but you apprehended, you arrested us. But instead of locking us up, you set us free. Father, we pray we will enjoy this freedom. The enemy will not take our freedom away in Jesus' name. And in this freedom, we'll continue to pursue the best that heaven has for us in Jesus' name. As we go today, let your presence go with us. Thank you, precious Jehovah. We exalt and glorify you. For in Jesus' glorious, marvelous, awesome, wonderful name, I have prayed. Amen. The Lord bless you as you go.